I'm delighted to introduce Kumkum Ray, an assistant professor in the Department of English Literature at TS College in Chapra, Bihar. She's currently pursuing her PhD on the spatio-temporal aspects of the works of Michael Ondaatje at Banaras Hindu University. Academic interests are post-colonial studies, border and partition literature, diaspora, contemporary literary theories, and translation studies. I find it very brave that the deluge of papers that we got, not one potential presenter chose the skin of a lion for explication. I'm looking greatly forward to Kumkum's paper and the talk of the voices from the margins in early 20th century Toronto. So the cityscape during the Great Depression by migrants, which was built by migrants, come to the fore, and there are echoes of Hannah and Caravaggio and Patrick in the English Patient. Kumkum, looking forward greatly to your paper on multiculture and Toronto. Go ahead.
Thank you, Julie. Good evening, everyone, and thank you for such an engaging session. Today, I'm going to discuss on cultural mosaic and the city space in the skin of a lion. So, as we all know, Michael Ondaatje is a Sri Lanka-born Canadian author, is a champion in exploring and bringing forth the unheard voices of the margins. From Sri Lanka, Ondaatje migrated to England at the age of 11, and later he moved to Canada and became a Canadian citizen. This diasporic identity of Ondaatje, depleted with immigrant experience, largely influenced all his novels, most prominently in one of his early novels, In the Skin of a Lion, which explicitly deals with this diasporic identity and the related homomorphism. The novel was written a year before the federal government of Canada passed the Canadian Multiculturalism Act that adds altogether a different dimension to the plot of the novel, which deals with immigrant struggle and exploitation during the early part of 20th century. The federal nation of Canada was mostly governed by its British and French settlers, was not much open for the non-Anglophonic and non-Francophonic immigrants. To keep a distance from the plot of the novel, Ondaatje chose to focus on the life and struggle of the European immigrants. In an interview in 1990, Ondaatje mentioned that he didn't want to write an Asian story for the very reason that it would have been interpreted as a personal saga. The major immigration to Canada has started during the early 17th century when British and French settlers, in search of opportunity and better life, came and settled down in Canada. There was a considerable number of American settlers as well, and gradually during 19th century, Canada saw migration from various parts of the world, including non-white Asian migrants. British and French settlers resented this increasing number of immigrants from different linguistic and cultural backgrounds, since they feared that these incoming immigrants could possibly and potentially affect the social equilibrium. As John Porter, in his seminal work, The Vertical Mosaic, an Analysis of Social Class and Power in Canada, published in 1965, identifies that the idea of an ethnic mosaic as opposed to the idea of melting pot impedes the process of social mobility. For the ongoing process of urbanization and development, the federal government of Canada needed a huge number of unskilled laborers to work in the factories, forests, mines, and mills. In spite of the growing anti-immigrant sentiment among the settlers, these migrants formed the major workforce in Canada since the early 19th century. following the Great Economic Depression and the Second World War, in an effort to unite the people living in Canada to battle up the crisis, the National War Service had formed an advisory committee which was responsible to bridge the gap between the Canadian citizen of non-British and non-French origin and the government. Such efforts on the part of policymakers made cultural assimilation inevitable. A completely new and inclusive approach to nation building emerged in 1970s by the Liberal government of Pierre Trudeau, a policy that acknowledged the contribution of other ethnic cultures and communities in nation building. According to Trudeau, the connection of the cultural communities, that they too are essential elements in Canada. The main protagonist of the novel, Patrick Lewis, native of farm migration, brought him to Toronto. The landless proletariat Patrick joined the other migrant proletariat coming from various European ethnicities like Macedonians, Greeks, Finns, Lithuanians, etc., denying and thus rejecting their individual names and ethnic identities. The labor agent in Toronto imposed new English names on them with which they never identified themselves, and then remember these foreign syllables like numbers, and this creates an ethnocultural hegemony which obscures the linguistic differences, their national identities, and imposed forceful homogenization on the migrants. Ondaatje, in his novel In the Skin of a Lion, has explored this vertical mosaic of ethnicities and class division in Canada. As rightly said by D.G. Roxana, Canada was a nation, as a nation, built on the immigrants' labor. Though the official history of Canada doesn't record any documentation of their contribution, as Turner observed, that even the data on exactly how many buckets of sands were used to build the Blue State Viaduct or the water reservoir gets an entry in the official documents, but the people who actually built the goddamn bridge were unspoken of. To survive these labors had to work long hours of toil and dehumanizing environment in the tunnels where the air is murky and hard to breathe. And minimum human dignity and the hygiene was compromised. They had to eat their lunch standing beside somewhere someone else had peed or defecated, and the continuous presence of the mules and pit horses in the muddy, slippery surface had reduced them to some subhuman creatures. At Wicket and Craig's Tannery, the nature of the work is much more gruesome. Ondaatje reflected that the works of these tanneries have had inhaled the kind of poisonous gas that any human being could ever possibly gone through, and as a result, most of these workers suffered from tuberculosis, arthritis, rheumatism, and were destined to die early. As Ondaatje mentioned, they had consumed the most evil smell in the history, and a year from now, they would have burped up that odor. Working almost naked in the pool of dye for long hours has changed their skin colors permanently. This change of skin color has been rhetorically associated with various non-British ethnic identities, which is sabotaged by the notion of generic English-speaking Canadian identity. Key passage to symbolize and reflect upon this ethnic disparity, Ondaatje has illustrated the visual of the dyer standing out of the pool in different colors that have changed their human appearance permanently and thus transformed them into a colorful collage resembling the diversity of their ethnicity. But Ondaatje has also added that celebration of such spectacular scene would be false celebration, a satire on humanity. In spite of their contribution in nation building, they were considered foreigners and special laws were imposed to restrict their activities. As Ondaatje has mentioned in the novel, in a self-reflexive manner, that police chief Draper has imposed laws against public meetings by foreigners and use of any language other than English may put them behind the bar, a rule of the city. In 1938, during the post-economic depression, the government of Canada started to deport these immigrants due to the rise of anti-immigrant sentiment among the citizens. The omniscient voice in the novel mentioned that in 1938, over 10,000 foreign-born workers had been deported out of the country. Toronto City Police, Danny Starper, established a new well-trained unit of police modeled on the Red Squad of United States to combat the infiltration and the rise of trade unions in the unorganized labor sector by the communist union leaders like Cato. The allegorical puppet show where Patrick and his fellow workers were invited was a performance that defines the matrix of power structure and become a medium to show the other side of the society, which describes the oppression of the migrants and that normalized by the society. Two major characteristics to look upon of this episode is worth mentioning. Ondaatje underlines the fact that this is a nocturnal gathering at a half-built waterworks, which is hardly suitable for any kind of socialization. As Ondaatje mentioned in the novel, that it was an illegal gathering of various nationalities, and the noise of the machines camouflaged their activities from the watchful eyes of the authority. The play further portrays the truth of social assimilation and the experiences of the immigrants in Canada. The costumes of 40 puppets who were dancing at the background represented various nations and the ethnic diversity of the immigrant laborers, and thus the political representation of the migrants in Canada. Gradually, as the plot builds up, the main hero of the show, who is actually performed by Alice Girl, Patrick's earlier acquaintance and who later becomes his beloved, dramatizes the struggle and oppression of the nameless and the unidentified workers. The humiliation of the hero by the civic authorities is the point where the people who gather to watch the show has resonated the most. Inability to speak the language of the oppressor made them silent sufferers. Through this show, Ondaatje successfully expresses the political and social dissent existed among the migrant workers, which was gradually mounting up against them. Watching this play transformed Patrick from a self-centered individual struggling for his own livelihood to a representative of all those who are not endowed with the tongue of the oppressor. This meeting of Patrick with Alice Girl changed the navigation of Patrick's life, which in due course of time formed the base of the confrontation of Patrick with the Commissioner Harris. And thus providing the novel its due exposition. The Italian immigrant Caravaggio, the thief, is an important secondary character to bring forth the racial discrimination towards the immigrants. While he was in jail, he was attacked with an intention to murder, and the sole cause of this attack was racism and xenophobia existing in the Canadian society. His attackers were polygamy oaths. This incident blatantly cites the prejudices and the uncalled for situation faced by the immigrants in Canada during the early 20th century. Ondaatje has very skillfully chosen his protagonist, Patrick, who is an English-speaking Canadian citizen of British descent, who could have easily climbed up the vertical mosaic of society, but becomes an anarchist and went to jail. On the other hand, Nicholas Temelkov, the daredevil who came to Canada without a passport or knowing the English language, has risked his life to earn extra penny and learn the English language to survive and gain the social mobility to distinguish himself by becoming a successful entrepreneur. As Ondaatje mentioned, his breads and rolls and cakes and pastries reached the multitude of city in the city. This exemplifies the flexibility of vertical mosaic of the economic prospects of the social political aspects of Canada during the early 20th century. Thus, the novel In the Skin of a Lion has successfully illustrated both sides of the sociocultural fabric of Canada by depicting an alternative history of the early 20th century and well-articulated background narrative which substantiated Canada's multiculturalism bill in 1970s without totalizing the point of view of the ruling class.
Thank you, Kumkum. Thank you very much. I just want to engage you in one question that I haven't been able to wrap my head around when I reread the novel Skin of a Lion. You know, Alice, the woman who is eradicated twice, right? When she falls off the bridge, she dies because she is from a lower social class, and she dies also, as Dr. Roma Bhattacharya mentioned earlier, about the idea of how women, the histories of women, are erased. Now, in your opinion, Kumkum, since you're really familiar with Skin of a Lion, why do you think, although Ondaatje has said that I've written this story about the Macedonian, the Greek, the Italian migrants, because he didn't want to be seen to only talk about Asian immigrants, right? But in your opinion, has he been successful in creating an alternative history and recognition for the European immigrants? And later, of course, he talks about Asian immigrants in a way with Kirpal Singh in The English Patient. Yeah. But now in this, why do you think he was pushed to write about the fact that the deaths of the European immigrants, there was no record? I was quite surprised to read that. What would you say?
Two things I want to mention, like what I find very intriguing about this female perception in Ondaatje's novels. Like it's an altogether different, discourse. Like, I think the first part of your question was like that. So when I read Anil's post, and somewhere Ondaatje mentioned this thing, like, he placed Anil in a male's world. Similarly, he placed Alice in a male's world. Like, we hardly have any other female name in the whole story, apart from Clara, which never represented the focus of the story, we can see. And about the second part of your discussion is that he is being able to represent the European migrants and why he has done that. So he himself, as I have mentioned, I have gone through the lines very, you know, quickly, since there was an alarm in my mind, like, you know, you have said 13 minutes. So Ondaatje himself said, like, he wants to avoid this, you know, we have this general tendency to impose the author's identity and author's personal life with the plot of the with the plot. So to escape that subjective, to draw that extra subjectivity from to the plot of the novel, he said he that's why he focused on the European migrants only. He himself said that I didn't want to write about the Asian migration. Since he wants to escape the attachment, that personal attachment with the story, like, you know, for running the family, he has to repeatedly mention that it's not his autobiography. So to
yes,
escape something,
yes.
even for the cat stable, he has to mention that it's not
yes.
his autobiography.
Yes, yes.
So I think to escape that tone. He has focused on the European immigration, and how far he is being successful. I think that's completely on us how deep we can delve into the topic. And I think he is the voice who registered this, who bring forth all this in front of us. Earlier we used to. We used to use the umbrella terms on that immigrants without any special ethnic background. We tend to homogenize this identity of the immigrants by putting the term immigrants,
yeah.
the outsiders.
Thank you, Kumkum. That was excellent, excellent. All questions answered. The next paper presenter is Harsh Kumar Singh. He's a graduate student pursuing a master's degree in English at St. Xavier's University. His paper title is Teen Strolls and Toxicity, The Dark Side of the Games Took Place in the Visadero. So it actually, the paper argues that just as modern video games offer a medium of an escape from the darker, grimier and more mundane realities of life, by making players enter a virtual world, Cooper in Divisadero, through the card games and poker, constructs a life out of gambling, trying to attain a sense of full victory that he could not accomplish in his troubled life. Harsh Kumar Singh is a literature enthusiast from Kolkata, writes as the muse strikes him. He's pursuing his post-graduation, as I said, from St. Xavier's University. Areas of interest include romantic poets, fantasy fiction, graphic novels, classical mythology, video game studies. Favorite writers, as I discovered, are Tolkien, Andrzej Sapkowski, Percy Bysshe Shelley, Stephen Fry, Lenore Campbell, Madeline Miller, and many others. His poem has been published in the anthology Butterflies, by the right order. And over to you, Harsh. Let's see what you bring to the table.
Okay, so perusing through the novel Divisadero by Michael Ondaatje, one will be drawn towards the card games that Cooper plays. Looking at the life of Cooper, his fascination and inclination towards card games, the various technicalities which he considered and played his hand brings into play the various ways in which playing was assessed by Johann Huizinga in his Homo Ludens. Roughly translated, Homo Ludens means man the player. Huizinga says that the play element in culture presupposes human society, for even animals play among themselves, which leads to the distinction of his first characteristic of the play, that playing is, and I quote, that playing is free and is in fact freedom. Cooper finds a sense of escape in the casino, the world of glitter, drinks, card, and cash. Herein, I'd like to bring in the concept of magic circle. Huizinga says that all play moves and has its being within a playground marked of beforehand, either materially or ideally, deliberately or as a matter of course. Just as there is no formal difference between play and ritual, so the consecrated spot cannot be formally distinguished from the playground. The arena, the card table, the magic circle, the temple, the stage, the screen, the tennis court, the court of justice, etc., are all in form and function playgrounds, that is, forbidden spots, isolated, hedged round, hallowed within the within which special rules obtain. All are temporary worlds within the ordinary world, dedicated to the performance of an act apart. So a magic circle is a space where there is a suspension of normal rules of the world, and in this circle, a specific set of rules and order is followed. The card games, much like any other game that Cooper plays in Divisadero, is also set in this magic circle. Cooper's proclivity and penchant for the card game may be considered an inclination to live in the world of the magic circle, because this space with its own order and rules is a better space than his life's reality. Barring the money that Cooper earns by winning, the sense of victory, of triumph, the rush, of adrenaline as he plays his hand and wins, makes him ecstatic. We look at Cooper's roller coaster of a life where he suffers one loss after another, losing his parents to a homicide at a very young age. He was adopted not as a son, but as a farm help by Anna's father. When there was a semblance of a stable relation with her, he was brutally abused by him, almost leaving him dead. Since his childhood, he has faced a depressing sense of monocopsis. There is in him this feeling of loss, the pain of losing both a father and a father figure, and the breaking up of a nascent relation, that too in a way which traumatizes him. The game of cards is the escape from such a traumatic life, and only in the magic circle does he feel any sense of control. This sense of establishment and victory, although just in a card game, makes him ecstatic because he has failed to have any control in his life. For other players like him, this tendency to drink heavily, there is a tendency of drinking because it multiplies the enjoyment of their wins, and that is usually often seen. For online gamers, it's usually energy drinks, which although give a short span of increased attentiveness and heightened cognitive abilities, it often becomes addictive, and overconsumption leads to depressive tendencies as well. Games, be it any game in the real world that we play or in the virtual world, is not free of any toxicity. When Cooper tries to make his own decisions, such as pulling in roughly $300,000, then standing up and walking away, Dawn says, "You fucking idiot, you're a child." This form of negative criticism and toxic behavior is not something that is only seen in casinos or this game, but in the online world as well. In any game, there exist trolls, people who deliberately make offensive remarks to disorient players or make them commit a blunder. It is a term mostly used online. The toxicity of trolls can sometimes be very detrimental to a player's mental health. According to a study of gaming toxicity from the Anti-Defamation League, we find that over 80% of multiplayer gamers experience some form of toxicity, with the majority of it leading to gender, race, ethnicity, sexual orientation, religion, or ability. Most players felt impacted by such toxicity, with over a tenth saying it resulted in depressive or suicidal thoughts, and over 20% said that it caused them to quit playing. With time, games have also changed, and in the era we live now, video games have evolved from basic 8-bit audiovisual interactive medium to essentially a completely independent form of game, which is no less than old-fashioned games. with the innovation and advancement, video games too have become a major escape from the reality of life, providing a magic circle that has crossed all limits of conventional games. Writers Daniel L. King and Paul H. Del Fabbrio, in their paper, Understanding and Assisting Excessive Players of Video Games, say that to many gamers, video games provide a sense of empowerment which they lack or rarely find in their real world. This escapism is a coping strategy in the face of adversity, which may have a positive impact or a harmful impact on the psyche depending on usage and the condition in which the gamers play. In Devisadero, we find that there is in the casinos of Nevada a complete disregard for the ongoing Gulf War. Ondaatje writes, for the 3,000 gamblers inhaling piped in oxygen at the horseshoe, the war is already a video game taking place on a fictional planet. The magic circle within the card table is more real and matters more than the Gulf War broadcasted in the television sets. A similarly peculiar incident has happened during the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic as well, with millions getting affected and dying, losing their jobs, bearing the financial crunch. There has been a boom in video game sales, along with a high demand for high-end PCs and consoles during the last 2 years. Just in a month, Microsoft saw an increase of sales by 130% of its Xbox Game Pass service from March 2020 to April 2020. Nintendo reported a 24% increase in sales of its Switch console in quarter two of 2020. And the game Animal Crossing New Horizons had sold 13.5 million copies by May 2020 since its release in March 2020. Video games have truly become an escape from the gruesome reality where COVID-19 exists. Moving on, the agenda and ideas that Huizinga has put forward has also drawn criticism, but do remain valid when we consider Cooper's life. Huizinga says that play can be deferred or suspended at any time. It is never imposed by physical necessity or moral duty. It is never a task. It is done at leisure during free time. Cooper has to pay to earn. He even goes on to learn the various tricks to defeat Autry's crowd from the Gentile, also known as Axel. If we would apply the tenets of Huizinga, we will find how much of the essence of gaming has been, although debatable, lost or transformed, for it is not just an activity done in leisure. For Cooper, it is almost a competitive sport, so much so that it is almost a career to him. He takes great financial risk too as he plays, since the money he would earn if he wins can set him free. With the evolution of video games, there has been an evolution of the genres of games as well. The online multiplayer genre best fits the argument of how nerve-wracking games could be. In games such as Apex Legends, Player Unknown Battlegrounds, League of Legends, and other such games where one has to defeat the rival or enemy team based on strategy and in many cases with a team effort, one has to think of the whole strategy of the game, the way an army general and soldiers discussing an attack talk. The build up anxiety, pressure, and stress is nerve-wracking. Circumvent the shack with a car as I go in, look out for snipers. You're covered by enemies on one side, do something. Throw a smoke grenade and run towards the shack on the other side. Are but some tricks suggested by players to another in the famous game PUBG. The various tricks and strategies that Cooper has to use and that he learns from Axel, trying to understand the way the other player plays, the same lingo. Don't give them a chance to draw again. Slow down your deal. You missed two corrupt shuffles. The player on his right habitually cuts his cards, roughly the same spot every time. Don't riffle sack for just a minor haul. Is spoken in various points of the second chapter of Devisadero, and the pressure under which Cooper has to play has somewhat the same energy. We also see the violence that got associated with gambling, especially Cooper's neck being stabbed with a syringe, him being forced to work. This tendency is reminiscent of the various homicides recently committed in India by adolescents over mobile games, as can be seen in the next slide. Finally, the element of play converges into Cooper's past, which he had no control over. However, his skill as a player gave him some catharsis, and this was the only way he could make sense of his life, as equivocated by Anna, and I quote, who recovers from such events. You meet people in age and discover that at some point in the delicate path of life, they have been turned into the Jack of Hearts or the Five of Clubs. This is what has happened, I suspect, to Coop and to me. We have become unintelligible in our secrets, governed by our previous selves. Thank you.
Absolutely fascinating. You know your subject well, you know the theories well, excellent application. But we'll come back after Raka finishes her presentation on the Visadero, and I'm hoping that, you know, Roma, Harish, Jean, Parthiban, whoever's here, Gifty, Dev Shurjo, you can jump in here and perhaps we can look at this gaming issue, which has really got a very violent edge, Harsh, in Akupa's life. So really happy to present one of our star scholars who's got a first class in her master's about a month ago. The results were declared. And Raka Mukherjee is going to talk about a paper title is A Palimpsest of Contested Identities. And again, it is an area which has not been worked on in Canadian literature. A comparative study of Ondaatje's Divisadero and Alice Munro's Gulfs. Raka, all yours.
Thank you so much, Milan. Good evening to everyone present here. A palimpsest of contested identities. For we live with those retrievals from childhood that coalesce and echo throughout our lives, the way shattered pieces of glass in a kaleidoscope reappear in new forms and are song-like in their refrains and rhymes, making up a single monologue. We live permanently in the recurrence of our own stories, whatever stories we tell, Anna in Michael Ondaatje's Divisadero. Ondaatje's novel Divisadero is a prime example of layered storytelling through cyclical narratology. The idea of retelling of stories and lived experiences fit like pieces of jigsaw in Ondaatje's fiction. The novel entails multiple narrators who chart the trajectory of the lives of a little girl, Anna, and her adopted siblings, Claire and Cooper. The first part of the novel narrates the story of three young children brought up by a single father in California, where Anna loses her biological mother in birth. Claire had also lost her mother, born alongside Anna in the same hospital, and Cooper was brought up less like a son and more like a helping hand in the farm after he lost his family to a homicide. The second part follows up on the dismembered lives of Anna, Cooper, and Claire after Anna and Coop were caught in the act of sexual intimacy by their father. The brutal rage of the hostile father had led to Anna attacking her own father to stop him from beating Cooper to death. Claire, who had been a silent witness to what had happened, nursed Cooper back to health, and from that point, Cooper and Anna escape, leaving Claire back at the farm. Hence, tracing the journey of the adult Anna Coop and Claire, the third part of the novel traces the life of Lucien Segura, a French poet whom Anna had been investigating, and his life that mirrors the relationship between Anna and Coop and intensifies the trope of the absent father. Anna fixates her own lived experience with Lucien's life in a way to cope with her new assumed identity. While trying to write his biography, she recreates the disintegrated past and tries to remember and write into Lucien's story, her own story, for the readers. Similarly, Alice Munro, in her short story Dulls, uses the metanarrative genre to establish the identity crisis of Lydia, a middle-aged woman who visits the island of Grand Manan to rediscover herself, trying to escape her past relationship and attachment. She learns about the island being a site of refuge for Willa Cather, who was an author, and absorbs her personality into her own, trying to regain the self-confidence that she had lost from the trauma of breaking up with Duncan, her last lover, who had destroyed her self-esteem and led her to find self-worth only through his validating gaze. In my presentation, I will elaborate on Ondaatje's use of the narrative technique to present to his readers the intersection in the identities that Anna identifies in her archival research of the life of Lucienne throughout the novel, and at the same time analyze Munro's use of memory and intertextuality to present to her readers the psychological metamorphosis of Lydia through the authorial voice of Villa Cather. The comparative study would help in identifying the personal experience of Ondaatje and Munro engraved in their fiction. This would lead me to discuss the first layer of the palimpsest, the dialogic unity of voice. Mikhail Bakhtin, in his essay Discourse in the Novel, described the multiple voices as the term heteroglossia. He said, and I quote, "Within the arena of almost every utterance, an intense interaction and struggle between one's own and another's world is being waged. The adaptation of the heteroglossia in the narrative voice employed by Ondaatje and Munro is composed of the event of utterance within utterance. In Divisadero, this layering of narratives occurs in multiple stages. It begins with Anna's interaction with Raphael, her French lover, and the traumatic past that brushed through the life of Lucienne Segura, in whose biography she would discover her own past. The contested identities truly intermingle in Lucienne's relationship with Marie-Neige that reminded Anna of her affair with Cooper. The authorial voice gains the dialogic unity as Raphael utters that Lucienne had once told him that a solitary writer would find contentment in writing stories, as the writer would essentially be in his busy and crowded world of invention. Anna, now leading a solitary life, was writing about Lucienne's days of writing fiction based on his unfulfilled relationship with Marie-Neige, who, in spite of being the wife to another man, had kindled in him the feelings of love. Their shared love for reading and camaraderie had led to Lucienne spending his solitary days in the war writing about his inconsistent hero Roma, and Marie-Neige and Jacques, who, realizing he was writing his own longing into it, writing was the only tactile connection that allowed the characters to perceive and relate the experiences to the level of universality. The palimpsest deepens in Ondaatje's fiction from the trope of the absent father. The novel explores the father-children relationship with Anna, Claire, and Coop, Raphael's with his father, who was a thief by profession and changed name like passwords, and Lucienne's stepfather, who was a clockmaker and raised him for 5 years, belonging to separate time and memory scapes. The relationship always led to a separation from the father figure, either by a physical or a metaphorical death. The event where Anna and Coop's affair was exposed to their father had marked a metaphorical death of the relationship and a permanent separation from the father figure of all the three children. Lucienne's father, who was a clockmaker, with his affection towards his mother and him, in a span of 5 years, had instilled a sense of family that he could never find later in his life. For me, it was perhaps the last remembered pleasure belonging to him. It is the unspoiled core of whatever I know of love and family, and I have not been successful at the craft of it. There was a calm. The two clocks in the house were silent but precise, and we were safe in the time. Ondaatje's own dysfunctional relationship with his father and his death is perhaps ensconced in the microcosm of the absent parents of Divisadero. In Running in the Family, Ondaatje had written about his life back in Ceylon and ended with the death of his father, Mervyn Ondaatje, the idea of a solitary death, the loss of a language, the lost touch of a caregiver, to becoming foreign to a life once lived, all find expression in the change in identities found in Divisadero. Similarly, Munro's Lydia and the connection with Villa Cather finds its origin in the authorial voice of Munro herself. The dialogic unity lies in Munro's personal visit to the island of Grand Manan and her experience of domestic Canada. The Ontario landscape that is recreated in the story, that developed an elaborate psychologism of Lydia's past, is nothing but echoes of real people Munro had encountered throughout her life. Lydia is a poetess who suppresses her artistic self, which perhaps could only be the independent part of her personality. On the other hand, on learning from Stanley about Villa Cather spending her life creating art in a solitary cabin in the island, gives her hope, almost like a cathartic repose, and she identifies with the character of Mrs. Forrester in Cather's A Lost Lady. The element of memory acts as a bridge between Divisadero and Dulles. The bridge of intersectionality in the voices of diasporic Canadian writer Michael Ondaatje, who had lost the first Sinhala word, Vatura, and adapted the English tongue to write his experiences, and the Anglophone Alice Munro, who created the Jubilee landscape to tell stories of domestic struggles. According to John Locke, in his essay concerning human understanding, the self is a thinking, intelligent being that has reason and reflection and can consider itself as itself, the same thinking thing in different times and spaces, and by extension defines personal identity simply as the sameness of rational being. This connects memory to one's consciousness, and as far as consciousness can be extended backwards to any action or thought, so far reaches the identity of that person. It is the same self now as it was then, and it is by the same self with the present one that now reflects on it that the action was done. However, theorists like Thomas Reed had identified the problem of Locke's assumption, as his theory suggests memory and event are absolutely necessary to be in sync in order for an incident to have happened, and it is a sufficient condition for self and personal identity. However, in the narratives under discussion, memory is unreliable, cyclical, and manipulated. This is a deliberate technique to establish the coping mechanisms that the characters undergo in Divisadero and Dulles. In Divisadero, Anna's selective decision of suturing her wounded past through the story of the solitary Lucien becomes her coping mechanism to immortalize the love she had for Cooper. Lucien spent his solitary days writing, alienated from his wife and children in the cabin of his deceased stepfather. Anna, in writing Lucien's story, seeps into Cooper's identity, who learned the skills of the farm from their father, who raised him, and at the same time, Cooper becomes Marinesh, the forbidden lover for Anna. Both Anna and Lucien face the death of their mothers, and finally Lucien returns from the war to find Marinesh abandoned by her husband, dying alone, affected by diphtheria. In her last night, Marinesh could not identify Lucien and mistook her for her husband, Roma. Similarly, Cooper, on losing his memory, affected by the heroine, mistook Claire as Anna, as he did once before in the horse barn. The physical wound of their childhood and the switch in identity was perhaps Ondaatje's style of presenting his readers, a premonition of the psychological wound their personality would undergo later. Claire was caught up between being the daughter to the father who adopted her but refused to speak, and being the sister to Cooper who mistook her for his past lover, Anna. She was the other twin, left in a crisis of her own. The cycle of misidentification and loss of memory perhaps could be traced back to the demented frenzy of Mervyn Ondaatje, Michael's father. Mervyn, under the influence of alcohol, had spent his life detached from his wife and children. He never knew the globe of fear that his father was, and tried to perceive him through his letters, his writing, and his imagination of how he must have spent his last minutes. In his poem Letters and Other Worlds, Michael wrote, "My father's body was a town of fear. He was the only witness to its fear dance. He hid where he had been that we might lose him. His letters were a room, his body scared. He came to death with his mind drowning." Similarly, when Ondaatje makes Anna say, "There was a sweet shadow and hesitance in Segura. It was like a ruin glove. It was somewhat familiar to me. His voice with the wound in it kept haunting me." And finally make her confess about the night she had escaped to her new life, the desire to tell the story to Coop, whom she knew she had lost to a life she could not return. He was perhaps speaking for the past he knew he could not return to in Ceylon, to his father. As Anna said, "He was lost to me and I was far away by then in another life." The idea of memory in Dulles is significant to the narrative technique where Munro presents Lydia with Mr. Stanley and his connection to Villa Cather. The artistic self of Lydia gets an outlet to identify with the idea that Cather had created art and survived in the same island, and she constructs her disgruntled self-image through identifying with Cather's art as a muse. Lydia assumes the role of Mrs. Forrester, imagining the men as her lovers and having the need to be constantly defined by her marital status, trying to break through the shackles that her past lover Duncan had imposed on her. Her identity is dependent on the adjectives assigned to her by Duncan. Craig and Lockhart, in their models of memory, talk about levels of processing. Lydia's conversation with a therapist gives hint about the time-sharing process in memory studies, wherein the deeper levels of processing semiotic words and experiences construct and validate memories of people. Duncan's opinions and her marital status have seeped into her self-identification. The autobiographical palimpsest in Dulles could be identified by Munro's personal life when she had written Dulles. Munro had been divorced with two daughters in 1973. Dulles was published in The New Yorker in 1980. After her second marriage, Lydia's self-doubt about her age and her inspiration of expressing her artistic self through Cather's life is perhaps a reflection of her own coping mechanism to her changing domestic life. In an interview in 1974, Munro had said, "I think most of the stories start with real people, and then this character is almost lost. And then something in my mind is doing with it and building into it and changing it. You know, most of the incidents I use do have their starting point in something that really happens. The contrapuntal voices of Ondaatje and Munro therefore echo through Anna Lucien and Lydia Stanley Cather, respectively. They meet at the idea of suppressing parts of their past and rebuilding their personal identity by trying to provide the readers with the gaps where they participate with their own experiences and try to perceive the dysfunctionality of the characters and by extension the author. Therefore, the final layer of palimpsest happens with the Barthesian idea of the birth of the reader, the glottal in heteroglossia, or the voice that the reader hears and perceives that transcends place, time, language, and nationality. As Ondaatje in Divisadero had signposted, everything is biographical. Lucian Freud says, what we make, why it is made, why we cannot forget, everything is collage, even genetics. There is the hidden presence of others in us, even those we have known briefly. We contain them for the rest of our lives at every border that we cross. And both Anna and Lydia meet at gliding into their newfound personalities. One could only remember their past like a faint dream, an imaginary homeland of the past. Their past relationships become a ghost for them. I only hold your shadow. Since those days, I drove your nature away. A falcon who became a coward. 9 sentiments, Michael Ondaatje. Thank you so much.
Raka, I'm still catching my breath. So much to digest in that. So much to digest. Roma, do you have any comments?
Question, as I totally agree with you, we need Raka's paper to digest it slowly. Absolutely, I can't agree more. And
Roma, go ahead.
Reflect on our own selves. I think that's what, you know, this notion of suppressing bits of ourselves and rewriting it through other voices, the Barthesian notion of, whether you like it or not, other people's reading of you impinges. I think that was very, very interesting. Thank you so much.
Raka, I have a few comments, but I will open it up and see if anybody else wants to say anything. Jean, are you there, my dear?
Yes, I'm here.
Jean, I was just wondering, because you, to me, you have come through today as the memory expert. in your ontological as well as your experiential explication of running in the family, is there a notion about memory that you would like to perhaps interrogate Raka with?
I'm not sure. I'm thinking about that paper. I was thinking as Raka was reading, I was thinking about Toni Morrison's use of the word rememory.
Yeah.
Especially in Beloved, but elsewhere in her critical writing as well, think about the ways in which in the Freudian construction, it's a
how we working, remember.
Restating, working through, returning to over and over again, because you do a kind of forced defamiliarization of the memory. And so it becomes less raw as you return to it over and over again, which I suppose is the whole point of talk therapy, right? There's the reason why people are in therapy for 10 and 20 years is that they are still revisiting the wound, the scene of trauma. And every time they do, it's like debriding a burn, you know, it gets, the skin comes in fresher and a little stronger every single time. So I think that process, which Ondaatje is clearly going through and running in the family and elsewhere in his works, even when it's a little more divorced from his immediate concerns, I think he's following that formula. He's healing himself slowly by repeating the scene of trauma.
Yes, that I think he's mentioned that in a very disjointed way. And this is a question for both Raka and Harsh, since you've both explicated the Divisadero. So Ondaatje says that in Divisadero, and I quote, the loss of coop is the essence of the book. He says that the loss of coop is the essence of the book. So in a way, my question to you is that, and it's connected to what Jean was saying, the loss of coop, if you can equate it to the loss of the father in running in the family, right? Raka, we've done this, and we've got Roshni and Radhika here as well, and Mohini, Ayushi. We've revisited this idea of how Patrick died in a dove coat, that famous and favorite line of ours. Can you sort of, and then I'll let Harsh have a go at the idea of coop being lost to Anna and to himself through gaming, right? So can you relate this idea to whatever we've done, and even the other texts of Ondaatje that we have looked at? The idea of the loss of coop is pretty much connected to the loss of his father. And that's where memory comes in, to retrieve that again and again.
Ma'am, the idea of the absent father, I mean, takes me back to our discussions on the English patient and how we talked about Hannah. And, you know, we had a lovely presentation on the skin of a lion today. And then the sequel to it, the English patient, we come to know that the idea that Patrick died alone in a dove cot, and how Ondaatje also remembered in Running in the Family how Mervyn passed away, and you know, in his poem Letters and Other Worlds, which you read out and I had included in my presentation, that he was alone, he was under the influence of alcohol, and nobody was there to tend to him. And we can only imagine how solitary the death would have been. But then it makes you question how solitary life was also for them, how alienated they were to their own family members. And the children who have these absent parents, the figure of the absent father, Anna, Coop, Claire, Lucienne in Divisadero, Hannah in The English Patient and in The Skin of a Lion, and the search for a father figure. So the longing and the validation of the father never really goes away. And I think Ondaatje really writes his relationship, complicated but very pertinent relationship with Mervyn Ondaatje, into all of his texts. Even in Anil's Ghost, this happens. I have had the privilege to read three of his novels, but I would relate most the absent father, most relatable to Divisadero, because we see so many father figures. We see the father of Raphael and how he is a thief and he changes his name like passwords. So he is basically moving in, shifting his identities, and because he was a thief. But then again, the motive of the thief, there's also Caravaggio is also a thief in The Skin of a Lion and then in The English Patient. So when you look at the thief, what are they really thieving? They're thieving their identities. A part of their identities is being lost and stolen and exchanged in the new families that they form. And Ondaatje himself, in the interview, which I think you mentioned in your introductory talk, he had said that, you know, I talk about families, but I talk about dysfunctional families, not the functional ones per se. So I think even Roshni and Radhika could come in and talk about the absent father, and Ayushi and Sena and Mohini, everyone. But this is my take.
Radhika, Roshni, Ayushi, Mohini. Roshni, go first. Quick. The absent father.
Yeah, quick. So I'm so glad to be here, and especially to be in a discussion where I am back with my subject. I've missed it for so long. So, yes, Raka, and absolutely as usual, amazing presentation. So, yes, we did learn about the concept of the absent father in The English Patient, because that's the only novel I've read by Ondaatje, and how he establishes it through Hannah's constant longing for a father. And this longing for father, we also connected with the longing for home, because she also wanted to go back to the place she was born. And Pam had also explained in class how it's very similar to Nachi's own personal struggles with his father, and how he was so detached. And this sense of detachment, I feel, he uses it as a memory. So detachment and memories come together in his novels, and what it creates is a beautiful story, ultimately.
True. True. Thank you, Roshni. Radhika, want to chip in quick?
Firstly, thank you, ma'am. This is such a good refreshing of all the lessons that we've had, and to see Raka up here, it was really like we were back in our class with Ondaatje, and it's so engaging. Raka, well done, really. Ma'am, I think this concept of memory and identity, when we take it into context with the absent father, becomes even more important, because there in that war zone, in with respect to the English patient, they are in that ruined villa away from their particular homelands, and there are characters who are not with their families, and they have this added burden of the trauma. So we really see how life gets alienated after the war, because the war becomes a very important context in the English patient, as we see. And I think the loss of a family member, especially somebody like a father figure, and the way Ondaatje has incorporated that into the novel, becomes absolutely significant while we go through it. And we cannot do away with the fact, as I've always loved the concept of identity, that when you're struggling with locating your own identity in unknown spheres, in a different land, what do you bank upon? You relive the memories of your loved ones. And the only thing that Hannah could recall was the dovecot, and this dovecot becomes a kind of sheltering memory in which she locates her own father. And somewhere through this process, we see how Michael Ondaatje beautifully explicates the relationship of his father with himself into the novel. And I think that's the palimpsest which Raka has explicated beautifully in the presentation.
True, very true. I just want to connect the dots with you, Radhika, and say that Michael Ondaatje, in several interviews, has said that the reason he wrote Running in the Family at the time that he wrote it is because something had to be mended. Roma, it comes back to conversations we've had. He says his first wife and he were in the middle of a terrible divorce. You know, that separation, he'd had two children with her. And he said when that was happening, he needed to go back to Sri Lanka and find his family, his father. So what you say makes so much sense in that context, that that mending of memory, that mending in ontological reality, all is impulsed or sparked by the idea of the root of his identity, which is his father and his fatherland, which he's lost. Ayushi, anything to add?
Ma'am, first I would like to congratulate Raka for the excellent presentation of the paper. Like, this is such an unconventional topic, taking in Munro and Ondaatje. And when it comes to the absence of father, I think it's not just a part of English patients, but all of Ondaatje as a person, as a writer, and it is reflected in most of his stories. And it's not just about the persona of father, it's also about the fatherland, which I will be coming back tomorrow with tomorrow. My topic. But okay. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. So I think, yeah, that's it.
Anyone?
If I may, Julie,
Roma, go ahead, dear. Go ahead.
Very quickly,
go ahead.
completely different note. Because my brain works on systemic issues. I absolutely loved Harsh's presentation, and very, very disturbed about the, this is something that has disturbed me for a very long time. And that is the way in which the world of the battleground in a video game kind of routinizes violence. And I think the notion of play, I mean, there is Harsh a very positive, wonderful side of play, but there is this world of the space of play. In fact, the artistic imagination in the largest sense is a space of play. But in your presentation that you brought out very powerfully, which disturbed me, not your presentation, but the issues, is how when the trope, if you think of gaming and the video games as a trope, and it's a trope that is extremely universal at the moment, especially under COVID, and especially in North America, I do know there's a lot of research on this, how the battleground is, if you like, being sanitized because you can press a button and you can decimate the enemy. Do you have any thoughts about this?
Right. So with when it comes to battlegrounds or any kind of a shooter game, we call these games shooter games. I think these games are very impressionistic. To young minds, especially if I talk about India, India has been a country where there hasn't been a lot of game study development. And if there has been, it is something very recent. Mm-hmm. And with the kind of economy we have and the kind of demography, most people did not play games or know about games. There are only very few gamers or people who participate in gaming. And once this, especially this game, PlayerUnknown's Battlegrounds, PUBG, when this came to the mobile version, there exists a PC and Xbox version. When it came to the mobile version, even small kids are very impressed on the, it's impressed on their minds. And, you know, I feel that these violent games, although in one sense, they sometimes really provide a relief to frustrated minds or a very tired mind, because naturally, if you win this, there is always an ecstasy of winning, be it winning at a game, winning a prize in a competition, or getting the first prize in something. Winning is always a good feeling. However, to impressionistic minds of adolescents, if you bring in this, shooting games, it makes them more violent because there is nothing to channelize it. No one really, because most parents or most guardians, they think that, just give the kid the phone so that he's silent for some time. You know, this attitude exists, but what he's doing with the phone, how he's playing the game, what he's doing, that is not known. There have been cases of children, maybe of what, 17-year-old, 14-year-old, even 10-year-old, who have stolen the credit card of their parents to buy stuff within the game, right? And if I shift the viewpoint from here to generally gaming, I think that I am myself a gamer and I research a lot on it. I think that gaming, in a way, it can be, it has certain very pedagogical value. However, there exists, maximum toxicity exists in multiplayer games where you even start cussing at the other players. You get so aggressive that it becomes a very bad, it becomes very detrimental to your mental health. Mm. So, yeah.
Thank you. I was really talking about the routinization of violence. Wonderful. And I think tomorrow's discussion of Anil's ghost, I think the whole nature of writing such a novel is to contest the routinization of violence, because you actually, he makes explicit the war in Sri Lanka, civil war in Sri Lanka at 100 different levels. So sorry, that was just my take. Thank you
so much. That's fine, Roma. Looking forward. Radhika, Roshni, lovely seeing you. Gifty, see you tomorrow. Kum Kum, lovely paper. Raka, Harsh, you really took it away. Jean, you've been a tour de force. Thank you so much. Radhika, everybody. Bye for now, and over to Dr. Harish to say his goodbye.
So I just wanted to just sum up a few things that happened today. And I think Professor Harshana has, what he's done is he's given us a macro picture of cosmopolitanism and nationalism and some of the major themes into which all, most of the presentations fell into the slots that he sort of mapped for us. Nationalism, and within Ondaatje's novels, at least some of them, racism is a trope. But he never, because he's such a craftsman of the word, that whenever he writes about racism, be it in The Skin of a Lion or in Running in the Family, there's evidence of that, you know, it's not heavy-handed. It's just a few fragments and a few words here and there strewn on the page that say much more than a novelist who would have adopted a heavy-handed approach to explicating and explaining racism. And the other point about his history, because, you know, his novels are deeply steeped in history. But again, you don't really think when you're reading his books that you're reading anything that's, the heavy hand of history is absent. So it's there, but it is very creative in the hands of a master craftsman. History sort of dissolves away, leaving an aroma without its, the heaviness of history. So that's about it. And one of the final points was about Harsh's talk, is that you're escaping as a person in, you know, Coop is probably escaping from the humdrum of daily existence of a terrible life into the world of card games, becomes addicted. So it's no more an escape. He's escaped from his life and got trapped in the prison. So, you know, he's now trapped again. And will he get a break out of that jail to rock another day? You know, so is jailhouse rock going to happen in reverse? Is he going to break out of jailhouse and then rock, live to rock another day? So with that, since I've been authorized to call proceedings to a happy end, I shall do that. We remarkably just run 5 minutes over time. It's amazing. And I thank you all for keeping time so nicely. I bid you good night, and I hope to catch up with all of you tomorrow again. Bye for now.